It is always a pleasure for me to preside, and a particular pleasure for me to preside for one of my colleagues. As you know, Joe and Kurt and I have now been here for 2 years. Our contracts were renewed. And it has been such a wonderful experience for me to really get to know Joe and Kurt better, and to work together with them. The New York Society can be a challenge. And it's good to have dear friends and colleagues to share that challenge with. And I know that for ourselves, we experience that eliciting the best in each other. And it is our fervent hope that we elicit that for the benefit and for the service of this community. Joe is also the leader of the Bergen Society, has been there for many years, and has the distinction, as we were reminded in our retreat when we play Ethical Culture Trivia, that he was the youngest leader in training. Even though we have a couple of young people now, he still entered at a very young age and made a firm commitment, which he still holds and has now shared with the New York Society his years of experience. He also teaches human rights at Columbia University and so many other things. I'm going to leave it at that so that we can just get into what I know is going to be a wonderful platform address from my friend and colleague, Joe Chuman.
Everything Ann said about our colleagueship, I ditto. Thank you so very much, Ann. It's a real pleasure working with you, and at times being indeed inspired by your dedication. It's really marvelous to behold, and we're all fortunate, I think, in the New York Society that you are here in your capacity. Let me also extend my kudos with regard to the celebration that we had yesterday here, right in this place, for our 100th anniversary of this building. I think the program that we were witness to yesterday itself was a thing of beauty. And it's perhaps easy for us to forget that a production that was only an hour and a half long had behind it the labor and love of hundreds of man hours and woman hours in terms of putting it together. And I think it coalesced into something that I found was elegant. It was appropriately brief, and it was really pitched, I think, just the right key for us. And it brought in a diverse range of media in terms of song, spoken word, film. It was really quite a marvelous production, worthy of the Ethical Society, and a nice way to launch our second 100 years in this meeting house. What I want to do is keep that spirit alive by looking at our proud history and then just briefly talking about the way in which our history can inform our future and what needs to be done by those people who love this place and are dedicated to it to ensure a robust future for the next century. I know that sometimes people think my platform addresses are a little too beefy, but our history is beefy, and I've long believed that history devoid of a context is indeed very superficial. So I guess what I'm doing is begging for your indulgence this morning. I want to do it right. This is, of course, a very proud moment for the New York Society for Ethical Culture, and rightly so. As you know, and as mentioned yesterday, we formally celebrated the centennial of the founding of this, our magisterial meeting house. For 100 years, it has resonated with the voice of reason and the call for social justice. This building and the community which it houses has been a virtual incubator for hundreds of projects, both large and small, many forgotten and many ongoing, which have literally given hope to and have improved the lives of countless thousands of New Yorkers and many people beyond. It has also served as a beehive, which has attracted innumerable visionaries, organizers, and activists to inspire and be inspired as they dedicated themselves to the cause of humankind. The New York Society has always been relatively small, but very mighty, and irritant on the body of oppression and injustice. This morning, I want to join in the celebration of our triumphant history. But I also want to look at those dynamics which fed into ethical culture, those historical currents that it so creatively rode that enabled it to become become such a fount of new ideas, such a powerhouse of progressive activism in its first half century. First, I want to review the roster of luminaries whom I briefly cited yesterday during our formal program. One of the most attractive things about our history is that this place has been a magnet for hundreds of progressive luminaries who, even if they did not join as formal members, found in ethical culture an ally, a kindred spirit, a force that they could work with to push forward their vision of a better America. As I noted yesterday, The Nation magazine, whose allyship, by the way, goes back to the time of the founding of this meeting house, the editor of The Nation, Oswald Garrison Villar, okay, who was a grandson of the great abolitionist William Lloyd Garrison, was the editor of The Nation magazine, and indeed was a devoted member of this society in the early decades of this last century. But The Nation remains a contemporary ally, and it devoted its October 4th cover story to short vignettes on those whom it considered to be the 50 most influential progressives of the 20th century. I read that article very avidly, and I counted among those 50 progressives fully 9 who were profoundly inspired by ethical culture or whom our movement had deeply influenced. And those 9 were, and I won't sort of expound on them, were Jane Addams, Louis Brandeis, Florence Kelly, John Dewey, W.E.B. Du Bois, Roger Baldwin, Eleanor Roosevelt, Pete Seeger, and yes, Bill Moyers. There were many more luminaries, in fact, in our orbit whom The Nation did not cite, but arguably could have. Among those group, we might include such progressive activists as Jacob Riis, Lillian Wald, Samuel Gompers, William James, and perhaps surprisingly, Walt Whitman, who was deeply engaged in the Philadelphia Ethical Society when he lived in Camden, New Jersey. If one can name a common thread running through them all, especially the earlier ones, it was a spirit of optimism, a sturdy sense of self-confidence, and an unwavering belief that the future could be better and more just than the past. The 19th century, the century in which ethical culture was born, was probably the most optimistic century in the recorded career of humankind. It is said by historians that the 19th century didn't really come to an end until the end of World War I, which, because of its unprecedented bloodletting, dimmed hopes and raised the question of exactly what type of creature human beings are. But as implied, the founding of our meeting house took place in a time when people remained confident in a sunny future, and ethical culture was one of the instruments which would help bring about that future. Indeed, I continue to believe that however dark the days ahead may appear, it remains the mission of ethical culture to keep the flame of hope and progress alive. Let me delve a little bit into history, to look at those forces, social and philosophical, which congealed in the mind of Felix Adler in 1876, when he founded the New York Society for Ethical Culture. When ethical culture began, it was something new, something indeed religiously radical. Here was a new religio-philosophical movement of warning in the West that did not place at its center a supernatural deity. No God to worship, no God to swear obedience to, no prayer, no religious rites, no holy scripture with inspired figures to emulate. Not too many symbols either, and I just want to say, for those who don't know, these statues, which may make some of you uncomfortable, indeed do not represent the Holy Family. They are, to relieve your conscience, generic pilgrims, okay, whether you like them or not, I tend not to, but let's put it in the right symbolic context. But ethical culture, we should emphasize, was not a negation. It was, in fact, a spirited affirmation. Despite what its critics wanted to see, it was not an atheist organization, nor did it replace God with man. Rather, it replaced God with supervening and inspiring ideals of justice, of truth, of beauty, of respect for the sacred dignity of each man, woman, and child. It looked not back to a biblical age, but ahead to a glorious future in which human beings would no longer be treated as tools of one another, mindless drones, or enslaved beasts of burden. It envisioned a harmonious future in which all human beings would be mutually engaged in bringing out what was best in each and all. Ethical culture replaced God with ethical ideals, religious dogma with the free mind, the biblical past with a vision of a just future, and worship with a dynamic and inspired commitment to do good for the sake of family, friends, and the society of humankind with whom we all share a common destiny. The world had never quite seen anything like ethical culture before, but like all things new, it did not come from nowhere. It was part of the spirit of the age. Felix Adler, through his training and brilliance, was able to catch that spirit and bring it one step further. And what was the matrix, we asked, out of which ethical culture was formed? Let me mention a few things that were in the air that Felix Adler breathed. First, there was the compelling authority of science. There was no century in which science had greater prestige than the 19th century. For educated religious thinkers to hitch their beliefs to the authority of science was to validate their truth. Sure enough, Charles Darwin caused a lot of believers a lot of angst, including Felix Adler, who concluded that Darwin had a lot of right things to say about biology, but was dead wrong when it came to the origin of morals. But nevertheless, Adler was a modern figure, and he wanted ethical culture to be a modern movement. And being modern, most of all, meant accepting the deliverances of science as an explanation for the natural world. For Adler, trying to get a personal, supernatural, miracle-working deity into a world justified by science was like trying to put a square peg into a round hole. He had once written, in fact, "I have created a new movement that will be, quote, ultra-scientific without being anti-scientific." And we've got to unpack that a little bit. An offshoot of science, and one that very directly informed Adler's thinking, because he was an adept in it, what was known as the higher criticism of the Bible. Like Adler, the higher criticism began in Germany, but emigrated to America and was carried forward, among others, by the great Unitarian preacher and abolitionist, who was also a biblical critic, Theodore Parker. What the higher criticism did was to engage scientific methods, including archaeology and history, to decipher when the books of the Bible were actually written and by whom. The conclusion was that they were written, in fact, by human beings at datable periods and not in the order in which the books of the Bible appear in the canon. Adler, who knew his Hebrew, Latin, and Greek, was part of that movement to deconstruct the Bible, and in fact taught the higher criticism when he went off to Cornell University right before he founded ethical culture. The higher criticism did not destroy belief in God or religion, since one could still hold that the Bible was written by men who were divinely inspired, but it sure did liberalize religion, and Adler was one of those liberalizers. But where does the ultra part come in, I mentioned ago, as in Adler's phrase that ethical culture is, in his mind at least, ultra-scientific without being anti-scientific? As noted, whereas he thought science was authoritative in explaining the natural world, Adler believed that it could not be the source of ethics. Despite the fact that Adler came to the United States when he was barely 6 years old, his mind to a great extent remained in Germany. Adler was a philosopher. Except for thinkers like Karl Marx, who were what we call materialists, a major strand of German philosophy is known as idealism. In briefest terms, idealists believe that ideas are real, that the mind is primary, and that the mind gives shape and meaning to the chaotic stimuli that come through our senses. As such, ideas, including moral ideals, in some sense, to use a fancy word, transcend the world of sense experience. Because ideas are thought to transcend and precede our senses, their content is understood in some sense to be free of constraints. Hence, Adler's high regard for, quote, free mind and free conscience in ethical culture. God, too, is understood by believers to transcend the world of nature, but what makes this notion of transcendence different is that it is created by our minds, by us. This type of idealism is a little bit mystical and a little bit romantic. It was identified with the German thinkers George Hegel and especially Immanuel Kant, whose philosophy was in Adler's blood and was his primary inspiration for what was to become the intellectual groundwork for ethical culture. The notion of transcendental ideas leads to the fourth current absorbed by Felix Adler, and that was the thought of the preeminent American sage, Ralph Waldo Emerson. Emerson and Adler actually met when the sage of Concord was in his 70s and Adler was a 20-something upstart kid. Emerson had prophesied that America would one day produce a religion of pure ethics, and we can see ethical culture as a fulfillment of that prophecy. Emerson was a major luminary of the movement known as New England Transcendentalism. Emerson had laid the groundwork for much of Adler's thought in his commitment to a religious outlook with elevated ideals, in his intuition that an impersonal spirit permeates nature, the world, and us. Emerson called this spirit the oversoul, and in his love for the genius of American democracy. Adler came to feel that Emerson's philosophy and his ethics weren't social enough. Remember reading in high school the essay, Self-Reliance? Okay, Adler wasn't quite there. But there is no doubt that Emerson made a great contribution to what was to become of the movement that we had inherited. A footnote on Emerson. After the Civil War, a number of liberal religionists who were inspired by the radical, almost humanist religion of Theodore Parker, whom I mentioned in passing a moment ago, including left-wing Unitarians, liberal Quakers, Reformed Jews, Transcendentalists, and others, convened in Boston in 1867 to create something known as the Free Religious Association. Blessed by Emerson, who put in his old age, put in an appearance, the Free Religious Association was dedicated to an absolute freedom of thought and expression in religion, and the expression of conscience in the service of moral and humane deeds. Adler became deeply involved with the Free Religious Association, and in 1878, 2 years after he founded the fledgling ethical movement, he became president of the Free Religious Association. Adler introduced many ideas to the Association for Social Reform, but the organization seemed more interested in talking than doing, and Adler quit the presidency of the FRA 4 years later and recommitted himself to building the movement that he had started. We might speculate that had the Free Religious Association been more receptive to his activism, ethical culture would have indeed have died in the cradle. The last major influence that helped to inspire ethical culture was the Reform Judaism in which Adler had been reared and helped shape the backgrounds of many of its early members. Reform Judaism began in Germany, and Felix's father Samuel was a leading rabbi who was involved in updating Judaism for the modern age. When Adler started ethical culture in 1876, there were probably no more than 100,000 Jews in America, and almost all of them were German Reformed Jews. Back then, Reformed theologically was much further to the left than it is today. The rabbis were virtual philosophers and replaced a miracle-working God with some variant of Hegelian or Kantian philosophy. Reform was highly universalistic and interpreted the centerpiece of Judaism as what they called ethical monotheism, dedicated to bringing about on earth a messianic age of justice and peace for all humankind. It was not a far step from there to ethical culture. Many of the early members of this society had followed Adler from Temple Emmanuel. The German Jewish community back then was characterized by a desire for equality in Protestant-dominant America, a commitment to building social welfare institutions, and its meteoric economic success in a new and free land. To a great extent, these were high-minded and cosmopolitan people in their sensibilities. Price, Morgenthauer, Bamberger, Philine were names associated with the German Jewish elite. Remember that when you go to Philine's basement next time. And indeed, they were identified with ethical culture. The most prominent of them was Joseph Seligman, who started as an immigrant peddler in the American South, become a prosperous banker whom President Grant had actually tapped to become Secretary of the Treasury, a position that Seligman declined. Seligman was also the first president of the New York Society and an admirer of Felix Adler, who was 50 years his junior. His son, Edwin Seligman, also became a member of the society and worked closely with Adler on several projects and became a very prominent economist at Columbia University. For its first 34 years, the New York Society met in rented halls. Back then, before TV, 1,500 people would fill Carnegie Hall to hear Phyllis Adler expound on the issues of the day. Back then, when intellectually oriented preachers had something to say, the press would come out to get the story, and a reporter from the New York Times was often in the audience. Armed with Adler's brilliance and his vision, and fueled by the formidable resources of his constituency, ethical culture was primed to take on the social injustices of the day. The background and stimulus for its activism was the Industrial Revolution and how it impacted the working and impoverished classes in urban America. This was the age of the smokestack industries, of the robber barons, when the rich got richer and the poor got poorer, and there were few governmental safeguards to protect those who had no choice but to sell their labor in order to survive. After 1881, with the mass migration of impoverished immigrants from Eastern and Southern Europe, New York City began to swell with tenements, public hygiene was wanting, education was substandard, and by the end of the century, crime was rampant, drug addiction and prostitution were flourishing. We can see ethical culture in its first 50 years as an effort to redress the evils wrought by the Industrial Revolution. The litany of projects was formed were dramatic and are well known to us. The Visiting Nurse Service, the first free kindergarten for the working poor, which decades later morphed into the ethical culture schools, the creation of 6 model tenements on the Lower East Side, which benefited 3,500 families. While the settlement house movement is usually associated with the names Lillian Wald and Jane Addams, the first settlement in the United States known as University Settlement, which will celebrate its 125th anniversary next year, was actually founded by a colleague of Adler's, Stanley Coyne, who based it on a British model. This, plus Madison House and the better-known Hudson Guild, founded by the Society, are still operative here in Manhattan. But there were many more such visionary projects. The New York Society started the Child Study Association. The National Child Labor Committee, which struggled for decades and eventually won, after Adler's death, the first legislation to regulate child labor. In its first foray into international affairs, Adler railed against the Spanish-American War and became National Vice Chairman of the Anti-Imperialist League. In 1891, the New York Society founded the Blythedale Hospital for Children, first known as the Hospital for Crippled Children, which is still flourishing, in fact, in Valhalla, New York, in Westchester. Felix Adler was fascinated with municipal planning as a way to foster humane and ethical living. He served on municipal planning boards and was responsible for the design of Sunnyside, the neighborhood of Sunnyside in Queens, and Radburn, a neighborhood in Fairlawn, New Jersey, not far from where I live. And if I had more time, I would talk about how the structure of Radburn as a suburban living community actually reflects the template of Adler's technical thought and the ethical ideal. In 1911, Adler, who was much in demand as a speaker at black colleges, particularly Tuskegee in the South, organized the first ever international conference on race relations, which brought people from the 5 continents together in London to discuss matters of race and imperialism. Adler was one of the 2 delegates from the U.S. The other was the famed African-American intellectual W.E.B. Du Bois. But most of all, ethical culture was committed in its early years to the cause of labor. Adler saw the transformation of labor in the workplace as the linchpin to many social problems. The historian Moses Grishin, who wrote a lovely book on the Jews in New York in the early 20th century called The Promised City, cites that there was no preacher in New York more committed to the cause of labor than was Felix Adler. Adler supported the union movement, but he felt that both owners and workers needed to infuse their roles with a very heavy dose of ethics. While ethical culturists such as Samuel Gompers reached out to the working man directly, Adler worked with the owners and managers to bring greater humanity and fairness to the workplace. Adler created a summer school for ethics, where he expounded his theories of labor and morality. Among his students in this summer school was a future president of the United States, Woodrow Wilson. Adler, like ethical culture in general, was not revolutionary, but reformist. Adler referred to his social justice activism under the rubric of, quote, social reconstruction. We need to be clear about a few things as well. Ethical culture, despite its vast accomplishments, was not a barricades movement. It is not as if thousands of members headed into the streets to angrily demand change. As noted, for 34 years, ethical culture met in rented halls, and in the beginning, its leaders were referred to as lecturers, implying more of a university model. No doubt there was a hardcore of devotees and a much larger periphery of sympathetic followers who were the movers and shapers. A second point has already been implied. In the early decades, ethical culture attracted to it, as both members and friends, people of very formidable financial means who greatly respected ethical culture's mission and were willing to underwrite its projects. In the 1920s, when Adler had developed his plans for the ethical culture schools and then went on a search for funding, John D. Rockefeller Jr. came to his office and gave him a check to underwrite one quarter of what he called the Fieldston Plan, which was, in fact, $250,000, a lot of money in those days. So here are the factors which made for ethical culture's laudable success in its first half century. A new, fresh idea which inspired people to rise to their highest ideals. A young, brilliant, supremely articulate, and visionary leader whose intelligence brought him authority and respect in an age when intelligence and authority mattered. A constituency which included many who were themselves respected leaders in commerce and industry, and who saw in ethical culture a vehicle by which to express their American and civic ideals. And members and followers who possessed formidable wealth and were willing to contribute to it, to build new institutions that would uplift the disadvantaged. It is also important to remember that these were times when the economic injustices of urban America were very palpable and preyed on the conscience of the class of financial aristocrats who had a conscience that was open to being appealed to. And to be frank, Felix Adler and ethical culture were able to appeal to that conscience in order to leverage the money to underwrite the institutions they wanted to build. It was also a time long before the New Deal when social change was left in the hands of private institutions, primarily religious institutions. To be fair, ethical culture was not the only one, but it assuredly was among the most robust, visionary, and progressive. By the first decade of the new century, it was time for the New York Society to build a permanent home, which it did on what was then the northern frontier of Manhattan Island. Interestingly, at first, Dr. Adler was ambivalent. This was noted yesterday at our celebration. He felt that the continuous use of Carnegie Hall made the society all outreaching and more cosmopolitan. He feared that by having its own permanent building, the society would merely become a church among churches and thereby lose something of its external reach. But recognizing that having a permanent home would give the society endurance well into the future, he came around and played a major role in securing the funds and shaping the aesthetics of his meeting house. In 1904, the society purchased the land we are now on for $250,000, and the estimated building costs were about $600,000. In its design, which is obviously austere, simple, and almost totally devoid of symbols, excuse these things here, and by the fact that our auditorium takes up 3 of the 5 stories of this building, Adler was trying to emphasize the primacy of the spoken word as the vehicle by which to convey the ethical idea. The fact that the platform is below much of the audience, rather than a pulpit that looks down from on high, was meant to signal humility on behalf of the speaker. Written on the outside of this building facing east is a quote from Dr. Adler, announcing that ethical culture is, quote, dedicated to the ever-increasing knowledge and practice and love of the right, end quote. The awesome solidity of this building, I think, reflects Adler's commitment that the ideal to which ethical culture is committed, that is the right, so to speak, is as sturdy and solid as God is understood to be by traditional believers. But with the creation of this permanent home, ethical culture transformed itself from a lecture-based organization into a congregation and a living face-to-face community. Its work in social justice continued. I believe, though I haven't done the research to prove it, that the very early meetings of the NAACP, which celebrated its own centennial last year, were held in this very new meeting house. What is clear is that the New York Society was instrumental in starting that venerable organization. Oswald Garrison Millard, whom I mentioned as editor of the Nation, was also a member of the Society, and he had put out a call on the 50th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation, talking about the oppression of blacks in America. And no fewer than five ethical leaders were signatories to the original charter of the NAACP. At the successor senior leader of the Society, John Lovejoy Elliott, assisted a member, Roger Baldwin, in founding the American Civil Liberties Union around the First World War. Elliott, who was strongly identified with Hudson Guild, which he helped found, initiated a printing school, built a model tenement of his own, and secured Hudson Guild Farm, which is a rural farm about 500 acres in Warren County, New Jersey, which Hudson Guild just had to relinquish a few years ago. With Adler's death in 1933 and the ascension of Elliott to the position of senior leader, the character and philosophical outlook of the New York Society began to change. Adler was the high-minded orator and visionary. Elliott was the social worker who lived in Chelsea among the poor whom he so passionately served. In addition, with an influx of European immigrants, Adler's philosophical idealism began to fade, and ethical culture's class character began to change. The Society became a big tent under which liberals, agnostics, atheists, socialists, and other activists could find a welcoming home. Philosophically, Adler's idealism under the influence of John Dewey was replaced by variants of pragmatism, instrumentalism, and naturalism. Ethical culture then took on the mantle of a humanist organization, a term Adler had shunned for its emphasis on human ends devoid of the spiritualizing dynamics inspired by transcendental ideas. Perhaps no figure was more identified with this outlook than was Algernon Black. Black went to the ethical culture schools, got a BA in economics from Harvard, and became a leader of the New York Society in 1930, not with Felix Adler's total support. Al Black, whom I personally knew quite well, was a man of charismatic presence and grandiloquent oratory. Most people who got to know ethical culture in the mid-decades of the 20th century heard of it first by listening to Black's radio broadcasts on WQXR. Black was clearly a man of the left and often a polarizing figure in the ethical culture society, which was notably more conservative than he was. Black was a Cold War left liberal activist whose interests ranged very broadly. He became identified with the causes of racial justice, workers' rights, affordable housing, civil liberties, and anti-fascism. In the 30s, he spoke out against fascism in Spain, as he did later against Nazism. In the 1950s, he courageously denounced McCarthyism from this platform when few others dared to do so. The ethical culture was in the forefront of denouncing McCarthyism publicly. He helped organize silk workers who were striking in Paterson and Lodi, New Jersey in the 1940s. He was founder and chairperson of the Citizens Committee on Harlem, and he was a prime mover of the Committee Against Discrimination in Housing. He served as vice president of both the National NAACP and the National ACLU. I recall one meeting here I was present to which Black had invited members of the Black Panther Party, an event he had to pay for himself because the Board of Trustees refused. The culmination of his career was probably when Mayor John Lindsay appointed Algernon Black to be the chairman of the short-lived Civilian Police Review Board. But there was another side to Al Black. He was a marvelous storyteller who engagingly painted portraits when he spoke from the platform. He loved to speak to children, and for 40 years he helped shape the lives and ethics of thousands of kids as a teacher in the ethical culture schools. But Al Black's proudest achievement, and the one most expressive of his humanism, was the creation of the encampment for citizenship, which he did with the help of suffragist Danny Politzer, who was a long-standing member. She died at the age of 104, and they only got to know her after she was 100 years old, actually, and with the continuing support of Eleanor Roosevelt. The encampment in the pre-dawn of the civil rights era at first brought college and then high school-age kids together across racial, ethnic, and national lines for shared living and progressive community service. It had the honor of being denounced personally by Joseph McCarthy and others who saw it as a communist front. if not merely an unacceptable exercise in racial mixing. The encampment lasted for 50 years and trained a large cohort of activists, thousands of them, who went on to make their mark on American society. These are some of the real gems, there are many unstated, of which we can be duly very proud. There are many more unmentioned, as there have been countless thousands of people who have gravitated to this place and have been inspired by the message which has resonated within these walls. This work continues with our Women's Shelter, the Supervised Visitation Project, the Justice for Juveniles Initiative, and much more. But I ask to begin to bring this to a close, what about the future? Clearly, times have changed since Ethical Culture was founded and since we first dedicated this meeting house a century ago. Today, we confront a new set of challenges, but we also possess some powerful resources and enduring strengths. Among the challenges is the reality that whereas social justice was carried on a century and more ago primarily by private organizations, since the 1930s, government has picked up many of these functions, as have social service agencies, and local volunteer activism has become far more characteristic of the American landscape. Religiously, America has always been a matrix for new religious groups. The United States, in fact, is a religion-creating machine. We just turn out thousands of religions. But today, I would say, more so than ever, America is a veritable marketplace of diverse and competing religious groups, literally thousands of them. Many of them espousing ideas far more distinctive, I would say, than ethical culture. And as everyone knows, our human and financial resources have significantly grown much smaller. Even when I joined the New York Society here 42 years ago, it claimed a membership, in fact, friends, 10 times of what it is today. And as is evident to all, our class character has changed. Today, our membership reflects primarily the professional middle class. Back then, it was aristocratic, attracting the knights of industry, the periphery of very wealthy supporters who could be called on to underwrite specific projects. Personally, I don't see George Soros coming to my office anytime soon and dropping a check for $1 million on my desk, no matter how compelling a project I could cook up. And as I mentioned at the beginning, ethical culture then was riding the currents of greater optimism and hope, which nurtured a sturdy self-confidence. After two world wars and a century of genocide, hope in the human project does not come so naturally and is not so easy to sustain. So where does this leave us as we peer down the road ahead? I contend that we are left with many powerful resources by which to meet our current challenges. First and most obviously, we are the beneficiaries of this magnificent and magisterial meeting house. It remains and will remain a common ground for us and allies to continue to generate the inspirational, educational, and activistic work which is expressive of ethical culture's ideals and which the world outside these walls needs so very badly. Second, as I made clear in this talk, we rest upon a proud history and a very worthy legacy. This, too, serves us as a source of power and inspiration. But there are things which we must do as we focus our attention on the future. In the most practical sense, given the competing marketplace of ideas, we have to remain savvy to and ready to employ the latest technological communication, lest the message of what we do and what we are about never gets heard. We must be able to cultivate new sources of funding beyond our membership and identify those people with the resources who believe in our mission, admire ethical culture, and are willing to support generously what we do. Throughout its history, ethical culture has been very self-effacing in terms of what it's done. I suspect that many of the people who direct the organizations we founded don't today have the slightest clue as to ethical culture's involvement in their founding and history. Self-effacement, of course, does go hand in hand with ethics, but I think that we have perhaps been a bit too pure. There is nothing wrong with letting people know that we believe we have something of greatest value and we would like for them to join us. I think we need to get beyond a temperamental defensiveness about welcoming more people to us to become active members of our community. But there is one last essential thing we must do, I believe, to secure our future for the next 100 years. And in making this recommendation, I am primarily talking to my colleagues and myself. I have spoken this morning about our great public achievements in the field of social service and social justice. Here's our future. These are the tangible, concrete, highly objective things, and they are therefore the easiest to see and the easiest to describe. But there is an unmentioned element which lies behind them all, and that is ethical culture's message. As I mentioned at the beginning, when ethical culture first appeared on the scene, its message was radical, and that surely was an attractor. I think we have to remember that religions, especially in their growing phases, are countercultural phenomena. They stand against many of the values of the mainline culture. And it's that dynamic, okay, of critiquing the culture that makes them attractive. Today, with the proliferation of religious movements, I think we're not so distinctive any longer. One of our challenges, therefore, I believe, and I'll develop this more fully in my address next month, is that we are too indistinguishable in the minds of the public, and I dare say in the minds of many of our members, from what we might call a generic liberalism. Just as ethical culture carved out its message in the past against the background of the evils wrought by the Industrial Revolution, I predict that the context against which we will hone our message in the foreseeable future will be defined by the economic dislocations wrought by increased globalization, the challenges emerging from a multicultural society, environmental degradation, and the persistence of mass atrocity crimes, which reveal the dark side of human behavior. What we need to work harder at, I'm saying, is defining and communicating ethical culture's distinctive response to the needs and wants, joys and aspirations, hungers and longings, public and private, generated by the larger world in which we are all fated to live out our lives. We need to delineate and communicate effectively a distinctive ethical culture position on things such as marriage, on divorce, on childbearing, on bereavement, on death and dying, joy and tragedy, and social activism, and all the relations which we human beings experience. If we can do this intelligently and compellingly, in a way that touches people's hearts as well as their minds, the continuing relevance, our continuing relevance, will be assured, and the way ahead